Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to your National World War I Museum and Memorial. We so appreciate you being here this evening, in spite of, or perhaps because of, this really glorious April we're having, this April weather that we're having right here in the Midwest, which does not always feel like spring. As a matter of fact, in case you didn't know, there may be some snow tomorrow, not tomorrow, but over the weekend, I know, in Kansas City, and potentially tornadoes on Friday. Not anything close to what today feels like, which is a bit more like a sunny springtime California in 1917, when Arthur Clifford Kimber himself began an incredible journey, which you'll be hearing about this evening. When you are looking at some of the other things you might want to do over a potentially cold weekend, you may want to choose to come back here on April 15th at 2 p.m., that's this Sunday. Executive Director of the 1st Division Museum at Cantini Park, Paul Herbert, is going to be speaking about how the battle marked the U.S. Army's transformation into a modern military force. And next week, we'll be looking at Allied and Central Powers and the Ludendorff Offensives. So a little bit more about battles. But if you have been into our main gallery, you know that we don't just talk about battles here at the National World War I Museum. We tell the whole story from 1914 through 1919. And we are moved by the individual voices. We let those voices guide us through. Take a look and actually always specifically look for those red texts. Those are the quotes of the men and women who lived through and some who died during the war. It is their stories that Kansas Citians, 90 years ago, came together to preserve. And it's our pleasure to be able to share with you today and onward as we go into the future and as we keep these stories, not just now during the centennial, but moving ahead, because there is always an enduring impact. An enduring impact that former journalists know well. Good storytellers. I had the sheer pleasure of talking to tonight's speaker on the phone as I was walking across from the parking lot one day, and he was explaining to me this story. And it was a little surprising, because this beautiful BBC sounding British voice is sharing an amazing story of an American doughboy. And I thought, I can't wait to share him with our audiences here. Tonight's speaker, Patrick Gregory, worked for almost 30 years as a journalist and news editor with the BBC in London and Glasgow. He was also the managing editor of the BBC's political programs department. He has produced history and political documentaries for BBC Radio 4 and BBC World Service. He's lectured in the practice of parliamentary journalism in the Asia-Pacific region. And his book, on which he is speaking this evening, An American on the Western Front, which is co-authored with Elizabeth Nurser, tells this wonderful story, the vivid letters of Arthur Clifford Kimber. And you might notice that Amber is joining us this evening so that you might be able to purchase that. And I know that Patrick will be staying afterwards to do a book signing. Now might be an outstanding time, if you, like me, constantly carry around a pocket computer, to turn that to silent. are just a buzz. And then if you can make some noise and welcome Patrick Gregory.
Well, first of all, ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much, all of you, for coming here tonight. An honor to speak to you. It's an honor to be here at this museum, which I have kept in contact with over the years. I have written pieces about it. I have I've shared photographs of it. I've shared the story of it. It's wonderful to actually come and finally see it. And anyone who comes to, who's not in the room tonight, who may come and see this on a later YouTube channel of the museum, I would urge people not just to watch this or anything else on YouTube, but to come to this museum. It's a great credit to Kansas City. Thank you to Laura, who's the curator of education here, and to the chief executive, Matthew Naylor, for their invitation, to Camille Kulig for her organization, and everyone for welcoming me at the museum. Now, as Laura has said, it's quite strange that I'm not American, and I originally hail from Northern Ireland, and I live and work in London. And so it is a fair question to ask why on earth a non-American in America is talking to Americans in America about America and World War I and about a book, An American on the Western Front. The story began 6 or 7 years ago when my co-author Elizabeth Nurser and I got together to pore over a large collection of letters she had of a relative, her uncle, who was this serviceman in World War I in 1917-1918. Elizabeth is, I'm glad to say, an American, and she also doubles as my mother-in-law, God help her. And so, to looking at the story tonight of Kimber, why? Well, through his experiences, we can glean some benefit, some valuable first-hand testimony of the war. But it's also around the edges of his story and the time span of it that we can see a little bit more of the shape of the overall United States role at this time before, as well as during America's time as a full combatant. So if we actually start at the beginning in terms of World War I in summer of 1914, it wasn't the war something which the United States had really seen coming. In fact, the front office on this, the diplomats in the field in Europe, were taken pretty much surprise, as most were, when push did come to shove. A lot of the diplomats were in transit to the United States, already home here on leave. And the Paris Embassy, probably the biggest of the diplomatic missions in Europe at the time, well, they'd of course been monitoring and relaying what information it had had since the end of June, since the assassination of Archduke Ferdinand in Sarajevo. The ambassador in Paris at the time, Myron Herrick, had been warning Washington of the situation, saying it was the gravest in history, and he talked about civilization being threatened. Nonetheless, even he was surprised when it did actually happen on the 20th of June. He was hosting a reception for American municipal leaders at the embassy when news arrived of Austria-Hungary's declaration of war on Serbia. Even then, Herrick hoped that his country might be able to do something to try to help avert what he saw as a catastrophe. And he cabled President Woodrow Wilson, suggesting that, quote, a strong plea for delay and moderation from the President of the United States would meet with the respect and approval of Europe. Maybe, maybe not. I think that's maybe wishful thinking. But in any case, that was something that Wilson was notably more cautious about. As we know, Wilson did not want any part in the conflict. America didn't have a dog in the fight. He didn't see what was going on in Europe as having any bearing on American foreign policy or participation having any benefit. So the United States would stay resolutely neutral and on the sidelines. Neutrality was the watchword, neutral in thought as well as action. In Europe, in Paris in particular, neutrality, though, was to have a very active manifestation for Herrick and for the Paris embassy. The embassy and the American expat community there began to organize medical relief efforts for the war. An American ambulance hospital was opened, a volunteer independent military hospital, which independent, inverted commas, it gradually became very much wedded to the French war effort. And in the months that followed, Americans who found themselves in Europe at the outbreak of war, or who had ties of family or friendship with France, made their way to Paris, offering their services, working in that hospital, or increasingly, first in makeshift field hospitals, and then in a variety of ambulance services which sprang up. Drivers, a lot of them young college men from the United States, with Ivy League backgrounds very often, came to France to work for one of three main groupings that formed. The Hargis Formation, which was named after the J.P. Morgan Bank in Paris. Another, the American Anglo-American Corps. And thirdly, the American Field Service, which would become the largest of these, which grew out of the military hospital we talked about. In total, over this 14 to 17 period, some 3,500 Americans would drive these ambulances, more would serve in the hospitals. It was the first organized American presence on the Western Front, and it's something that our protagonist, Kimber, would later fetch up helping out in 1917. They weren't the only Americans to serve before April of 1917. Some joined the Canadian Armed Forces, some directly went into the British Armed Forces, of which Canada was part. Some went to France as foreign legionnaires, including the famed Lafayette Escadrille and Lafayette Flying Corps, flying with the U.S. Were flying with the French Air Service, but who would later become a key integral part, a backbone of what was then the nascent US Air Service. So who was Kimber? A 21-year-old student in Stanford, who left Stanford a few months before taking his final courses. But he actually, he'd originally come from New York, born in 1896. His father was an Episcopal clergyman in the Bowery, founding a mission chapel on East Houston in the boundary, in the Bowery, which was a mission chapel outreach of Trinity Wall Street. And Kimber Sr. wanted to save souls, but he also wanted to give a trade to the successive waves of migrants who would be coming off the boats from the old world. He and his wife wanted, alongside the promised afterlife, he wanted in this life to try to give these men and women useful employment opportunity, teaching them carpentry, needlework skills, anything else they could muster. And it was during this time that Kimber Sr. came into contact with Theodore Roosevelt, when Roosevelt was the city's police commissioner in the mid 1890s. Roosevelt was attempting to limit the opening hours of New York saloons on the Sabbath and shrink the sizes of glasses that beer was sold in. And they found common cause. Kimber wanted to keep folk away from the demon drink, and he wanted to keep families together. Roosevelt wanted to stop brawling in the streets. He wanted to keep more people out of hospital and in productive labor. But to spin on, a dozen or so years later, this is 1909 by this stage, the Reverend Kimber dies suddenly a year after he has taken the family on holiday in Europe. And in straitened circumstances, his widow Clara moves with the three boys Arthur Clifford Kimber being the second of them, to California. She had some family there, ultimately settling in Palo Alto. First Berkeley, then Palo Alto, hence the later Stanford connection. And it was there that the young Arthur Clifford Kimber, Clifford to his family, learned to fly gliders. He had seen Wilbur Wright demonstrate his Wright Model A aircraft in France in 1908 during the family holiday that I mentioned. So it is years later that we see Kimber inspired by Theodore Roosevelt, who he regarded as his hero, his father's former friend, inspired by his message that America ought to be out there serving in the field. That's why he wants to go in April of 1917. He is inspired by the work of the men already there, the American Field Service, so he wants to join that. And it is in the course of his time in Europe that after some months of service as an ambulance man, he then fetches up in the US Air Service, furthering his interest in flying. So Kimber, within weeks of war being declared in April 17, sets off from the West Coast, traveling by train across the breadth of the continental United States, carrying a flag. It had been presented along with three other flags in a large ceremony in San Francisco at the Civic Auditorium. And it was his particular flag was designated by Secretary of War Newton Baker as the first to be presented in the field in France. Further ceremonies followed in New York in the May of 17 after his train ride. On the 10th of May, which is significant in terms of dates at that time, he bookended either side the 9th of May and the 11th of May by the visiting war delegations of the French, of Marshal Joffre, and of the British by Arthur Balfour. The 10th of May, he parades this flag down Fifth Avenue. And he goes to see Roosevelt in his offices at the old Metropolitan magazine in New York, and the great man duly inscribed a good luck message to him in his notebook. He goes on to take the flag to Europe, and it's eventually presented in the field to a Stanford unit who have gone over a couple of months before, presented by the colonel of the 55th French Infantry Division with which they were serving. And it was presented on the 4th of June, 9 days before Pershing arrives with the first contingent of the AEF. What is interesting about the Kimber letters, and he wrote them as he left on the train in spring 17 until the night before his death in the autumn of 18, it's their sheer breadth. 160 of them at a rate of two or three per week, every week, for 18 of the 19 months of US involvement. And you can see a landscape. He comes in, it's like getting detailed postcards from a family member. He goes in, tells you exactly what he sees from the get-go. And you can get an actual, a real picture of what first America looked like, then Britain, then France. And it is here at this point, as he approaches Britain, that I want to pick up extracts from some of the letters from him. He'd been on board the St. Louis steamship, which was the first armed steamship to leave American waters after war was declared. A steamship that was armed with five different guns, fore and aft. So these letters, the first I'll read an extract from as they approach the dangerous waters off the southern Irish coast, where infested by German submarines. "We are now about at the spot where the Lusitania went down when she was unarmed and unconvoyed. This is in 1915, obviously. We passed an empty lifeboat early this morning. Also considerable wreckage, etc. Some life preservers were seen, and two or three bodies were spotted from the bridge. Some poor victims of the German U-boats. And later, about five, we passed some bales of cotton and barrels of oil from some wrecked ship. He witnesses passengers staying up all night on the final night of the voyage. Last night, Monday night, was the most dangerous of the trip because of our being right in the submarine zone. Many people sat up all night, and few of them took off their clothes. Nearly all the nurses on my deck slept either on deck or in the saloon. It was awfully funny when I returned to my room at 4:30 a.m. He'd got up with some of the others to watch the sunrise. Passing through the saloon to see ladies lying on the sofas and in the main entrance hall, men fully dressed lying on the floor. Those who stretched out on the deck not only nearly froze to death, but stiffened themselves for days to come. This idea of sleeping dressed in the upper decks is all bunk. He seemed to think that if it was torpedoed, the boat, he would have 20 minutes to get showered and changed. I don't share his optimism in that regard. The first troops he sees in Liverpool when he docks. As we drew up at the dock, we saw lots of soldiers and gallantly clothed officers. Some Highlanders were there, Hindus, Irish, Welsh, etc., and presented quite an interesting appearance. And a few hours later, he gets on the train to go down to London. As I looked at the passengers get on the train, many soldiers were getting on to go back to the trenches after a leave of absence, and their mothers, sisters, and sweethearts were saying goodbye to them. The men tried to be brave and not show their emotion, but the women were all and one, without exception, breaking down and weeping. Similar sorts of scenes in London. Late Wednesday night, I went down to Charing Cross Station and saw some wounded arrive. There was quite a crowd and they cheered heartily. Then an ambulance brought out the badly wounded, and the crowds no longer made noise for fear of disturbing the men, but quietly waved. And the game soldiers smiled and made feeble efforts to wave back. London is a regular morgue, dark and quiet at night. It is almost gloomy, and in the day it's quiet and dead. Similar sort of stuff then in Paris. Just give you the picture of him sending these letters back, so you get a fresh eye, a fresh American eye in all of this. Few of the men look happy, he said. They seem tired and careworn, dogged and yet melancholy, almost discouraged, as if they believed the war was never going to end. They need something to cheer up, to cheer them up and to stir up their pep. They should be supplanted by husky American troops and given a much needed rest, and they know that their poor families are practically starving for want of food and clothing, yet they cannot buy it, for they paid practically nothing. France is nearly exhausted. The U.S. has entered the 11th hour. American troops and flags are needed to rehearten the French poilu. He goes to Paris, then out to the front where the flag is presented, then to work. But the first bit of his work is tinged with excitement. It's almost as if he's there witnessing during a bombardment, as if he's a tourist at a 4th of July party. During the night, the Germans had started a preliminary barrage to an attack. It was wonderful. The French batteries replied and made a regular curtain of fire in the back of us. A German incendiary shell hit a big pile of rockets and made the most glorious sight I've ever seen with fireworks. All during the night, both sides sent up rockets, star shells, and red and white green lights. It was wonderful. As morning broke, the hill was covered with smoke and dirt thrown up by the shells. The gunfire sounded like a tattoo, it was so fast and regular. The boys had never heard such a barrage before. It was dangerous work, and still effectively shift work for these young volunteers. They weren't yet in the army, and they would do their dangerous 24-hour shift work and then would go back to camp and rest and take part in whatever voluntary activities they had, or their various hobbies. But it wasn't long before the raw realities of war forced their way through. Kimber understands the dangers he and his colleagues are facing, and one of their first aid posts is near a crossroads the Germans are continually shelling, and he's ferrying the injured to and from the rear guard evacuation hospitals. He visits the area around Verdun, two particular hills that have been much fought over, Mort Homme and Hill 304, and he witnesses the scene of devastation there. It was the most barren kind of a waste, torn and cut up by shell fire. Not a bit of vegetation remained. Hills nearby had bits of green, but in Mort Homme, not a thing. The strange thing to me is that the Germans threw so many men away trying to take this one hill. Of course, Mort Homme has a strategic importance, but even if the Boche took it and many others there, there would still be hundreds of hills left for the gallant French to defend. I cannot describe all we saw. We simply stared around and wondered. Occasionally, as the wind blew from the lines and no man's land, it carried a sickening odor, and other things equally horrible don't bear mentioning. By the autumn of 17, Kimber joined the US Air Service, being trained as so many American airmen were, largely by French instructors and flying French planes. And he trained, as was the norm, in a three-stage process of basic training, advanced training, and then gunnery practice. And he starts to describe in his letters home the joy of flying back to those gliders in Berkeley. It is wonderful to fly these fast little one-seater planes. You feel so like a bird and have such control in the air. You look out at the wings and there are only four wires on a side holding them and one V-strut each side. Great stuff. The world is below and you are in another world, challenging the eagle in his domain. Cut your motor off and you float silently and feel perfect peace and absolutely safe. Zigzag banking at 60 degrees or ride up and down, zooming and diving. You are alone. The avion de chasse is a fiery Pegasus and you learn to love it and care for it like a comrade. It's not all joyful. It's also very cold. This is in bleak, deep midwinter. And he describes one thing at the end of December of 17. The morning's flying was the coldest I've ever been through. One boy froze his nose and another his right cheek. The former rubbed snow on it to thaw it out and took the skin off. If you have a slight cold, flying in weather like this makes your nose run like a fountain, and that provides a lot of freezable matter. My feet were like ice. On the ground they were first cold, then felt warm, a bad sign, so I had to jump down, up and down until they got cold again. In the air where they were numb. High time Uncle Sam supplied us with the promised flying clothes. That took quite some time. And he describes then the dangers of doing some of this work. And a lot of these kids were killed ever before they got the front lines in training. And describes one thing. About 10 minutes before I landed at my destination, my left foot began feeling funny and sort of tingling. For a while, I thought nothing of it, as the vibration of the rudder sometimes makes one feel feet feel sleepy and numb. But about 4 or 5 minutes before I landed, my foot got really uncomfortable. It felt cold and wet, as if it was being pricked by pins and needles. So I ducked my head down under. Horrors! It was drenched with gasoline. My leg was wet halfway up to my knee. The shoe and putty were spongy. A veritable stream of essence came pouring it down. The gas pipe from the gravity tank had cracked, and half the gas flow was escaping. The bottom of the fuselage was drenched, and the gas fumes were awful. A backfire, and away we'd go. If the gas worked to the magneto and sparked, it would be good night. Anyway, he manages a safe landing, I'm glad to say, and changes his shoes and socks, puts on some blister powder, and then goes to the movies at the YMCA. And he finds time to stunt a little bit around the Chateau of France, especially if he sees pretty girls, he would kind of buzz in over them. This is kind of getting up his flying hours, but, you know, he was still a young man, after all. But then in an interlude, which tells us something about the American war effort at this stage, there's a long period of waiting while men and materiel and training, the supply chain, reach a critical mass, and the shape of the war begins to form. Kimber cools his heels for a few months, waiting very impatiently for the nod to go to the front. The Allies and the Americans at this stage were in a state of readiness over the winter of 17 into 18, and it wasn't until March of 18, and with the Americans that still at an early stage of preparations, that Ludendorff launches the first of his five offensives which will stretch out from spring into summer. So if we can, for a minute, press the pause button, take a step back, look a little bit more closely at the American war effort, how best to look at it in the round and begin to characterize it. Often overlooked or downplayed, certainly in Europe, but also curiously often here in the United States. Historically a time of huge significance, the first time the United States has gone out into the world as a full military and a political power, the beginning of the American century. John Pershing was having a tough time trying to get his armies into the field, transporting them, equipping them, training them, blooding them, also trying to fight off the interest of Britain and France in attempting to amalgamate them, a division here, a division there, into the British and French armed forces, the amalgamation crisis as it is referred to. Pershing was arguing the toss with the Allies about what priority to give troops and artillery, while he himself was trying all the while to assemble a fully functioning army. And that meant the full panoply, not just of heavy artillery, eventually tanks, of machine gun units, but it was also getting the service and supply chain up and running, getting the engineers in, getting all of the backup staff, the medical facilities, etc. Pershing did, of course, need to, during these offensives, come to the party, and he went to see Foch, the Supreme Commander, and said, "What we have is yours." But nonetheless, it was with a view to giving whatever support was necessary in an emergency, but all the while retaining the right to assemble and not have his men picked off. So what did the United States bring to the war when they entered? The four M's: money, morale, men, materiel, is what I would say. In fact, the money had already been happening way before America had their dog in the fight in April 17. The credit advanced to Britain and France and other competent nations. And morale was a vital component as well, and we should never, ever estimate it. April 17 was a time when the Allied war effort had taken a severe dent in confidence. Revolution in Russia had already seen off Tsar Nicholas, and when it did so, and when the Eastern Front collapsed, it was regarded as an inevitability that Germany would be able to be free to pursue its fight in France unhindered, moving over vast quantities of troops, which of course is what then happened. So that was also April 17. Although America was not able yet to bring its forces over, April 17, when they announced their intention to come, it was a massive morale boost, because the Nivelle offensive at the time had been such a round disaster. So much faith had been placed on it, and had it all gone to nothing. Mutinies began in the French army. So the news that America was coming was a great shot in the arm. The money I alluded to, Britain, for example, by the summer of 16, Britain was spending $25 million a day on the war effort. $10 million of it was being raised here in Wall Street. The final bill, Britain to the United States, was just shy of $10 billion. A lot of money then, as well as now. So the men, so that's the money, morale. Look at the men and materiel. The amalgamation crisis that I referred to, that that Pershing is trying to shore up his army. Eventually, compromise was reached with Baker and Wilson's involvement. Preferential transport was given for a period to infantry units only, which is what Britain and France wanted. That was a period that lasted for the latter part of the spring. But Pershing wanted to stick to the letter of the law given him in his original instructions when he left for France in 1917. He said, cooperate with the forces of the other countries employed against the enemy, and he repeated this back to Baker, but the underlying idea must be kept in view that the forces of the United States are a separate and distinct component of the combined forces, the identity of which must be preserved. He said, our forces should not be dissipated except for an emergency. Our forces will be stronger if our army, acting as such, shall have played a distinct and definite part. So the preparation of getting the men into the field, the first to arrive in 17 were the 1st Division, appropriately enough, the big red one, the apple of Pershing's eyes, the ultra-dependables who would be used time and time again over the course of the American War. Not long after, the 2nd Division, like the 1st Irregular Division, then the 26th and the 42nd, the National Guard divisions of different types. But these four divisions, the big four, were still the only combat divisions in France at the turn of the year 17 to 18. There was a depot division already stationed, the 41st, but only those four. And in time they would come in February, the 32nd, the 3rd Division began arriving in March, and then a trickle became a flood. 10 divisions arrived in April and May of 1918, around a third of the overall AEF strength eventually assembled, including the 35th Division drawn from here in Missouri and Kansas, including your near neighbor from Independence, Harry Truman, in the 129th Field Artillery Regiment. It was, by the same token and logic, for not only the assembly of these troops, but actually then what they would actually do. The first American-only initiative was at the end of May 1918 at Cantigny. It was a successful three-day battle about 20 miles south of Amiens, north of Paris, won by the 1st Division, commanded by Robert Lee Bullard. Relatively small in the grand scheme of things, but Pershing's men proved themselves, proved the Allied Deutschers wrong, and there had been many of them. It was touted rightly as a success by Pershing. The only slight problem, and it was a problem, was that the main action was happening 80 miles southeast at this precise time as Ludendorff mounts the third spring offensive. And he pushes on in unexpectedly rapid manner across the Aisne and the Vale onto the Marne. And it's then when the Americans really, really do have to, in an emergency, step up. The 1st Division were up in the north, so the 2nd and 3rd Divisions were brought in. And they fought their way, first of all holding the German forces off at Chateau Thierry, which will be a battle that will kind of rage on and off in the months that followed. But then a particularly bloody interlude in a place called Belleau Wood, a square mile of forest, which was quite medieval in its brutality. It involved a couple of marine divisions, marine regiments, and who actually not only won against overwhelming odds, but did so at this crucial time, leading Bullard, not even commanding them, Bullard of the 1st Division, to say, the Marines didn't win the war here, but they saved the Allies from defeat. Had they arrived a few hours later, I think that would have been the beginning of the end. France could not have stood the loss of Paris, this place being 56 miles from Paris. It was crucial what the Marines did. The savagery of the fighting in this war, in this wood, was brought home to me by the knowledge of the use of something they called toad stickers, which were 6 to 8 inch triangular blades set on knuckle handles. And one of the Marines talked of having had a lovely bayonet scrap and appreciatively of it having been murderous. We used butt strike and slash, he said, but no sticking because of time pressure. It must have lasted a good 15 minutes before they finally broke. But that was a, you know, I think sometimes people think of, you know, the mechanized slaughter of First World War, of tanks and of planes and of bullets and bombs, whatever. You know, it was also a time of dogs, carrier pigeons, horses, and this kind of fighting. So it came home to me. But during this time, as I say, if we spin back to our young friend Kimber, he was, during this whole time of gradual build-up and beginning of involvement, desperate to see the action, but he was just not in it yet. And he was acutely aware of the battle being fought on the ground in the trenches by these men. He's aware of his privileged position by comparison to this. And he said, 4 officers came in last night, 1 blinded by gas. It's horrible. Thank the Lord I fly. With me, the chances are I'll get off scot-free or be killed instantly. It's a great consolation after seeing those wounded and maimed heroes incapacitated for life. But I pity the poor fellows in the trenches. They are the men who will win this war. They suffer more than any of us and live in a regular hell. Hats off to them. They hold the line. But what's coming out then at this time as he begins to see service gradually is fatalism to his own position. An aviator's death, he says, is not a hard way to die. It's instantaneous. We do not fear it. I had a close call when I fell from 1,500 meters to less than 500. A few seconds more and all would have been over, but I wasn't thinking of what might happen. Confusion is fatal. A man must keep his head. One good thing about aviation is you're either killed instantly or not at all. There's no lingering death. But I hope and pray that if I meet death in the service of my country, I will meet it at the front at the hands of the Hun and fall like a shot eagle. When he gets into action, it is first as a ferryman ferrying the planes from the aviation acceptance parks and the factories to the front line or from one sector to another. Then he gets his first gig, as a lot of them did with the French, just as we'd had the Lafayette Escadrille and Lafayette Flying Corps. There was still, before they actually assembled fully functioning US Air Service aero squadrons, they would stick them in with the French to get their flying hours up and to do some damage in the field. So he served with the 85th Escadrille, one of the old Lafayette Flying Corps Escadrille. And I noticed recently when I was done some work on him, I noticed that he was the first person to have been given in the course of this a particular make and model of plane that was prevalent at the time, French plane used by the Americans, the SPAD 13, spanking new, very sleek for the time. And he was given the escadrille had just chosen a new insignia for their escadrille. And this was put on, so he was the first person proudly standing there beside this. And I noticed recently when I was looking this up that that insignia is still on the tail fins of jets flying with the, I'm trying to think of the name, the Auvergne Squadron, that's what it is, the French, in NATO exercises. It's a training squadron based, as he was, at Tours. Eventually, he joins U.S. Air Service in the summer, late summer, and fights in 2 of the conflicts. First, Samiel, and when he has a close call. Summit Yale, by the way, very quickly, was the largest air armada assembled in the course of the war, an American initiative, and it was assembled British, French, American, Italian planes, but it was the largest air armada assembled by the legendary Billy Mitchell, colonel and later lieutenant general. In the Samuel conflict, Kimber says, "So when the nine Fokkers attached us, Little and I were the first victims. He was the tail man. He was bringing up the rear, guarding everyone, the defensive midfielder in soccer ball. About four of the red-nosed, blue-bodied bastards jumped on me. They had height, and they were in the sun, and all I could do was to wriggle. At that moment, I looked below, and I saw that five or six other Fokkers had come up and were attacking the rest of the patrol. In a dogfight like that, it soon develops into a each man for himself, and the devil take the hindmost. Well, I was the hindmost. At the same time, I didn't like the idea of being easy meat. So no sooner would I avoid one than another was firing at me. Rat-a-tat-tat-tat, what a sound. Then a streak of pale, sickly, white, bluish smoke would whish over my head as the bullet flew by. Nick, his plane, he called it after one of his aviator chums who had been killed. Nick was absolutely riddled. I didn't even have a chance to fire a shot. I had to look in the back of me all the time. And with me, I don't like to fire unless my beads are on the other man's head. There's no use firing bullets wildly if they're not going to hit something. This is not a 4th of July celebration just for noise, sparks, and smoke. In order to escape the attentions of the various patrols trying to hit him, he then goes into a steep spiral dive, dodging tracer and sentry bullets, vertically down another 800 meters, letting the Germans think that they'd hit him, pulls out of it and makes his way somewhat unsteadily to the airfield. And his plane had been hit 100 times. It was unserviceable in the days which followed. And then finally to the Meuse-Argonne conflict, the giant conflict of the Americans at the end of World War I. And this is where he's killed. This is not a plot spoiler. We know this on page one, sadly. He can't write this. He writes his last letter the day before, the night before. So this is something that I had to write to actually put anyone reading a little bit in the picture of it. His patrol was in the task of the patrol was to operate at the top end of the sector, the 1-2-3-part sector that the Americans were attacking in the Meuse-Argonne offensive. The Meuse, the Argonne Forest, the heights of the Meuse on the right-hand side, and the large Montfaucon corridor in the middle, for those of you who know it. But at the top of this, the Kriemhilde Stellung, the German lines, their idea was to try to strafe on and behind these lines. And so he went up with his squadron leader to do the section up there. And in his case, Ray Bridgman, his squadron leader, went this way. He went the other, brought a couple of guys with them to strafe a road all the way up there. And it was halfway up this road that a place called Bonfield, which was a crossroads town, battery town of the German 5th, that took him out of the sky. He typically, even the fighter pilots would have small Cooper bombs on the sides of their planes, and so hit by fire. They did talk afterwards about it, you know, was it friendly fire or whatever, but the Germans certainly seemed to think that they had hit him. It was about 11:30 in the morning, and that was he went into a dive uncontrolled and crashed, and his comrades saw him do that. So that is the life, you know, the service, the death eventually of Arthur Clifford Kimber, the last 18 months of his life, of the 19 months of U.S. involvement. It's obviously only a snapshot of America's war, just one story in it. Kimber wasn't the first in the battle. He wasn't the last to die. But his story can help inform something of our overall understanding of the war. His life ended in late September 1918, but 6 weeks later, the US, fighting alongside the Allies, had brought the war to an end. It's an invidious task, impossible to try to sum up those 19 months of US involvement adequately to even offer a potted history of America's various battles. Cantigny, which I described, Chateau Thierry, Belleau Wood, the Aisne-Marne offensive, the Battle of Soissons, finally the two battles that I talk about there, the Saint-Mihiel and the Meuse-Argonne. For those of you who don't know, but you're sure you're an expert audience, anyone watching this, possibly at a later stage on YouTube, this was the last push of the war. The Americans began it on the 26th of September, and it was exceptionally difficult terrain that the Americans were taking on. And it's the largest single battle the US military has ever fought in terms of the casualties in it. Over 26,000 dead, around 90,000 injured or missing. 1.2 million involved in it. And more US service personnel died in World War I than in Korea and Vietnam put together, whether combat deaths or disease. But it is notable that it has got those statistics coming out of it, and yet it is a forgotten war. So I would simply ask people in this room, people watching, to try to process that and to actually begin to go again and have a fresh look at the United States involvement. That's the only thing that I can do, and ask you to go out and tell people a little bit more about it. So thank you.
Now, Patrick is kind enough to take a couple of questions from the audience, and I will come to each of you because we do have an audience online.
Could you talk a little bit about formal and or informal censorship or limitation on letters that were going back to the U.S. from American forces?
Yeah. In terms of him, yes. I mean, the first time I'm aware of him having stuff censored was stuff that he was writing on the boat when he was coming over. A lot of the time he was self-censoring to the extent that he was, he would be writing for place names, he would be writing M, P, C, whatever, and I would know laterally where he had been, where he had served, and was able to put the jigsaw together from that. I think there was, in his case, the sum of it was him kind of boxing clever and not trying to go into too much detail about, you know, this many guns, this many troop movements, this many plane movements, etc. He did complain. There was a time, I think it was in kind of January time, February time, I think, when he was getting more than a little peeved because, and maybe it was because they were stationed at the advanced flying school at Issoudun, I don't know, but and maybe it's because he was, you know, saying we want our equipment. I've no idea, but so there are little bits and bobs. For the majority part, the letters are remarkably uncensored, actually. So that was something that I was glad about. Anyway, I wouldn't be able to make it up.
I know that we actually probably have a couple more questions, but I know that you might be able to ask that during our book signing as well. I cannot begin to express first how much we appreciate you capturing the story of an American and sharing that with the world with your book and with this video. And thank you all for being here and for watching this online, and for continuing to research your own stories and sharing those. We would always welcome you back here at the National World War I Museum and Memorial to help you in that research. You can check us out online at www.theworldwar.org, where you can find a lot of archive and research materials. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you so much for being here. Have a good night.
Thank you.